So I think it's time to start the lecture. So good afternoon and welcome all of you to this promotion lecture by Mikael Lind. My name is Angela Hillemer, and as head of Department of Mechanics and Maritime Sciences, I have the great pleasure today to introduce Mikael Lind for his lecture. Mikael has been reviewed by internal and external experts for his new role with excellent judgment, and will, by this lecture, be awarded adjunct professor by Chalmers. So this is a collaboration between Mikael's employer, Research Institute of Sweden, RISE, and Chalmers University of Technology. Mikael has a great scientific network, as you can see by the number of the attendees, participants here at the lecture, and is the pioneer in this field of maritime informatics, an emerging discipline responding to global concerns. So we are all eager to listen to you, Mikael, so I will not steal more of this time. But the audience will be muted during the lecture, but you are all welcome to ask questions after the lecture. And we use the chat for technical issues and the Q&A for questions for Mikael afterwards. So thank you. Please, Mikael, let's start.
Hello, everyone. It's fascinating to see so many people paying attention to this. And I think that is a question coming out of that digitalization for the maritime sector is a very, very, very big hope and enabler and opportunity that we see here. And I see also in the participants that we have both shipping companies, we have associations, we have colleagues from Chalmers and RISE, we also have people from different corners of the world. So thanks very much. For those that are evening times, you probably sit and have a sip of wine. And for the ones that are just waking up, enjoy your breakfast. First of all, I would like to say that I think it's a little bit embarrassing because I think that this whole movement is built on collaborative foundations. We have been people working together within RISE, within Chalmers, and together with other academic colleagues throughout the world, but also a number of different practitioners. And I don't know if I should be the one that should be here at the moment, but thanks a lot for all that has been part of this. This thing started has been a long journey. Very early, Lighthouse initiated something called InfoShip, I remember that already back in the early 2014, me and Perry Holmberg had a presentation for the Swedish Ship Owners Association on the value of maritime informatics, and we really didn't know how to position that at that time. And as you know me, I have a background from academia. I've been working for almost 20 years in the academic sector, and then I came to RISE, and I've always been very fascinating about the interplay between practice and academic, or the practical and academic discourse. So being at a domain-oriented institution is fantastic, I think. If you look up on the maritime sector, I had the opportunity to visit Mayview-Maersk some years ago, and it was when it was berthed in a Scandinavian port, and I asked the captain whether he was in time. And Mayview-Maersk is a container vessel that I think it carries around 20,000 containers. It's 398 meters long, so it's a big ship, and what is said is that the ship consumes about 240 tons of fuel if it speeds 23 knots and 40 tons of fuel if it speeds 10 knots per 24 hour. And I asked the captain whether he was in time, and the captain said, of course I was in time. And then I asked, was the port ready? No, not this time either. I had to circulate for 3 hours. So there are things that we can do in order to glue the different pieces together in the ecosystem of maritime transports. So in this lecture, I will first talk a little bit about maritime informatics and the background for that and its foundations. And then I will look into a little bit what we can see around the corner and different applicational areas within this. So let me first start here and say that informatics comes from, and the way I conceive it, and me and my colleagues, is that it is founded in information systems. And we had a very early founding father, Börje Langefors, brought information systems to the academic context, and he also had an emphasis on both system thinking, but also how information systems can serve the object system, and the object system is of course on the practice or the business that we're looking upon. This has also meant that the information systems community has always tried to seek how we can conceive and interact with the practice or the human practices or the practices that we're looking into. It is an applied science and it is a socio-technical science, meaning that we do not develop information technology for its own sake. It needs to be put in context in somehow. It's a science for change because things are happening apparently, and it also relies on eclectic foundations such as system science, computer science, communication and behavioral science, economic, logistics, and business administration. And I thought it was a little bit funny. First of all, I will say that this has been a very, very long tradition with sea transports, and I think that already back what we dated to is when seafarers started to share information with each other in order to not hit grounds, and that was very, very many thousand years ago. So information sharing has been an important issue for a long time. And sea transports really enables nations to exert their comparative advantage, and this is what Adam Smith wrote in his famous book, The Wealth of Nations, that shipping enables the nations to exert their comparative advantage. And also the founding father of Chalmers, William Chalmers, he was a super carg, keeping track of the cargo owner's goods on the Swedish East India Company. And he's also an initiator of the Trollhätte Locks and Canal together with Peter Bagge. So we have a strong history in maritime also at Chalmers. So if you look at shipping, shipping is an important global industry. Approximately 90% of the world trade is carried by sea, and shipping is essential for the world economy. In 2018, the growth rate of shipping was 2.7%, and importantly for our consideration is that in 2019, the estimated global CO2 emission due to shipping were 2.2%. So this is of course an important area of concern, where aspects such as what kind of fuel are we using for the ships that are being steamed, how can we become and act more just in time, and how can we empower the circular economy, or the, what we call it, the maritime circularity in this field. So what we tried to do in order to push this area was that we, after 3 years of or two and a half years of the production of a number of concept notes that was brought out together and supported by maritime trade press outlets, statements and reports and notes were made both about the maritime sector and also together with the maritime sector, and that also enabled us to build a very good and large network of people engaging in this. And we then felt that now the time is there, so we also brought forward the book, the first book, Maritime Informatics, which has been launched by Springer. And in that we coined that maritime informatics is about the application of information systems to increase efficiency, safety, ecological sustainability, and resilience of the world's shipping industry. And I think that we can see now during COVID times that there is a lot of power that digitalization and maritime informatics can put into this sector, and the need for being very resilient. So, looking up on maritime informatics, what is at the core here? We take a balancing notion between, on one hand, enhanced or optimizing the capital productivity, which is very much on an organizational level, where there is a need for return on investment, etc., and balancing that in relation to energy efficiency, because as the self-organized nature of the ecosystem of sea transports means that we need to act in co-petition, basically, to ensure that we are securing that we do not pollute the world more than necessary. And as my example of maybe Vursk, you see that if the captain then could have arrived more just in time, and knowing in advance that there will be a delay of 3 hours, then he can slow steam, and that means that slow steaming means that you also both consume less fuel but also pollute the world less. It is also a question of that maritime informatics is responding to both organizational, global, and humanitarian concerns. Just to mention a figure, there are about 6,000 to 12,000 people that are dying every day due to starvation. And we are still sitting and trying to hold on our data because we think that that is a competitive advantage. We coin 3 focus areas: digital collaboration, which is supporting business models, incentives for engaging in interactions, and cybersecurity. Also, digital data sharing and decision making, supporting standardization and situational awareness. Data analytics, supporting machine learning, digital twinning, big data analytics, simulation, etc. We claim, and that's the reason why we need a separate informatics stream of coined as maritime informatics. We claim that it is the oldest and largest, or it is the oldest and largest sharing economy. It is global, as it stretches across industries and nations of the world, and it concerns many people. It is flat driven by markets rather than hierarchies, putting relationships rather than power at the core, with multiple diverse autonomous stakeholders operating in a competitive global market. It builds up on a federated and democratic governance to manage the self-organized characteristics of the ecosystem, with various and dynamic interactions between participants from different cultures that co-produce value for the clients of the ecosystem. The ecosystem is also governed by both international and sovereign state rules and regulations. It is asset intensive, and it does not allow for one owner, as many other industries are trying to pursue, to control the ecosystem. And the ecosystem is composed by many various dynamic and episodic interactions between participants from different cultures, and is to be classified as a complex adaptive system, as to be conceived as a self-organizing ecosystem. So what is covered then? And rather early, we try to bring forward this picture. And when it comes to maritime informatics has a big stake in supporting the sea transport pursuit in the world, by the about 90,000 ships visiting 8,000 ports, making about 20 million port calls per year in the different ports. It is also claimed that about 80% of all the ports in the world do not yet have enough digital capabilities to be part of this movement that everybody is screaming for. So, and here you see in this slide that we are looking up on digitally connecting people, goods, ports, ships, and infrastructure. It may concern, of course, connected port, connected ships, but also connected fairways. And we do have shore-based monitoring and coordination, both in the more authority-driven VTS centers, for example, as well as fleet operating centers. And this to enable efficient, safe, sustainable, and resilient sea transports. Importantly, however, is that we, in very many cases, of those 90% of the goods that is being transported by sea is connecting to another mode of transport. That means also that we need to assure seamless integration to other modes of transport, which are then driven by totally another regulations and other rules. And this is why the port becomes a very important and an interesting phenomenon to study. Our efforts of pursuing maritime informatics, we also developed a what we call the maritime stack, which is basically, you can look it up as the OSI model, which is has been very much referenced in the informatics community, where you have like a data communication layer at the bottom, and here we are then pursuing data exchange, data streamlining, decision support, and then we move upwards and talk about which kind of structures, such as markets, organizations, and partnerships that we need to implement efficiently, frequently occurring for occurring maritime decisions. And then we need to put a regional and national stance on this, reflecting how the practice is working. And at the topmost level, we need to talk about industry-wide international standards for a digital data exchange within the maritime sector. So, again, understanding the nature of the shipping industry help us to determine what types of information systems that might be successfully adopted. And again, this is then referencing back to that we need to create information systems that are supporting the object system. We describe the shipping industry as a self-organized ecosystem. There is no single keystone organization that issue command to other companies in the ecosystem, such as Apple, for example. Control is distributed among the various players in the ecosystem, each of them in this loosely coupled set of organization is continually adapting to the environmental and economic forces that it faces. And there are, of course, very much power structures where we have very, very big ports, we have very, very big shipping lines and shipping companies, etc., but we also have a number of different very much smaller players. Looking up on the transport industry, if you, for example, take DHL, I think that we see very often, all of us, I think, they only represent 3-4% of the market, so there are a lot of players involved for sure. And the same as the same thing goes for in maritime, and we also if looking up on ports, I think that 9 out of the situated in Asia, I think 7 of them six of them is China, and then Rotterdam comes there somewhere, place number 8, 9, 10. So. One foundation that we are building upon is organization as capital creation systems, and we are then not just looking at economic capital, which is the normal basis or foundation that many people talk about. We are looking upon that the capital inflow can be of different kinds, and then that capital inflow is utilized by the human capital, the natural capital, which is very prominent or very clear in the case of the maritime sector, because in the maritime sector we must use water, of course, and that's a natural capital. We might have social capital with a relationship to others. We have organizational capital and also a symbolic capital, and that creates our capital outflow. And here maritime informatics is built up on the foundation that is has been pursued by our great colleague Richard Watson. Taking this system stance is that we also look upon different system levels that have virtuous relationships to get the best out of digitalization. We would have system of engagement, that is the collaboration setting, that is demanding a system of production. And the system of production is then generating production data to a system of records. So, for example, if you a pilot booking might be a system of production, but that we capture it, we would do in a system of record. And then the system of record generates information for us to use in the system of inquiry, which could be machine learning, big data analytics, etc. And that we use for our potential reframing of the system or the setting that we are looking upon. Importantly, those systems need to capture, as we are dealing with organizational phenomena, human and organizational interaction, and their communication patterns need to be essentially understood and conceived. And that's why informatics is a good community to rely on, as it is also founded in the communication theories. Further, it is a socio-technical approach, which means that we need to study the interaction between the social system and the technical system with the different types of change, alpha, beta, gamma change, but also then seeing that, and I think this is a distinction that has been made before, we talked about loosely coupled systems, or we talked about tight coupled systems, and here we loosely coupled interactions, I mean, and the tight coupled interactions, but here we now talk about also episodic tight coupled interactions, due to the fact that you might only visit a port once in the lifetime of the ship, for example, or you are coming recurrently, but in between the visits, you do not have the connectivity to the port. It is a multi-organizational phenomenon, which also drives us to understand that, for example, a port is not one single organization, it's a multiple organizations that are involved. And you see that also stretching all the way from the cargo owner, having a need for a transport, and there's a number of different actors that are being involved in order to actually get the goods coming from point of origin to point of destination. Business and IT thereby needs to exist in concert, and incentives for IT investments need to be founded in business opportunities. And I hear reports, or we hear reports, of how much that has been invested earlier in big EDI connectivity or EDI interfaces, for example, and it's very costly to exchange them with all the stakeholders that you might have as a large company engaged in the shipping sector. So, taking this stance, what has been achieved so far? What have we been doing? We have been running rather large, I would say, projects. We were part of doing a number of people that has been engaged in this development, has been part also of the STM validation project and the definition and validation of Port CDM, as well as the definition and validation of S211. We ran Port CDM in deeply test beds in 9 ports in the world, and S211 became an international standard under IMO, maintained by IALA. We have two books actually published so far. I will tell you a little bit about the second one just coming out, with 130 plus co-authors from 25 plus nations, and this has been a true effort where we have united both practitioners and researchers in the same discourse. We have got an acknowledgement by international organizations such as UNCTAD, World Economic Forum, BIMCO, UNCFACT, UNEC. There are scientific articles that has been published in journals and conferences. We have run conference tracks at American and international conferences, and also a first course on maritime informatics has been given on advanced level by Chalmers. And we have also gained a lot of visibility in collaboration with a lot of our how should I call it, partners in international professional press, such as Maritime Executive, Splash 24/7, Digital Ship, Transinfo, Smart Maritime Network, Fathom World, Port Technology International, etc. So I think that this is something that really has gained some traction lately. And now also an acknowledgement of maritime informatics as an academic discipline, which I think is fantastic. So what is the need then? First of all, I think that we need to understand that what happens at sea and the seafarers, that is its own practice. And what happens at shore is another practice. And I think that it's very important that we find ways to connect what happens at sea and with what happens at shore. We want to have enhanced predictability of movements and operations associated to maritime transports. Today, the predictability is too low, so that forces our land-based operators to invest in buffers in different ways. It could be like a daily departure of a train. You secure that you have enough seats, etc. We need to have increased information transparency with direct and indirect stakeholders. Here it is very driven by the things that are the parties that are contracted. They do share information, but the other ones, why do I need to share information with those? Luckily, what we see and in our work in the European Commission, it is forecasted that the amount of zettabytes that are out there, 80% of them come today from data centers and 20% from connected devices. And what we foresee now is that relationship is going to be reversed by 2025. And that means that the intelligence that can be drawn out from very many connected devices, such as, for example, smart containers, would mean that we can challenge the ordinary process flow, so to say. Also, seamless integration with the multimodal transport chain, important, and also that we see that we as scholars need to act as engaged scholars, and practitioners need to act as reflective practitioners, joining the same discourse, which we then call maritime informatics. So, if you take this viewpoint of maritime transport as a self-organized ecosystem, we could see that we can take a foundational viewpoint of information sharing communities or how to conceive and work with information sharing communities. We need standardizations because that is the only way to come through and enable interoperability. We also see that no one can really dictate how the other one should act. So there is some kind of collaborative alignment process. And we also see that this is something that comes forward. What has been coined, for example, by the Economist, the appointment economy. So maybe that is a movement that the maritime sector might take. And this would then help us in developing sustainable and smart ports, smart ships, and smart cargo as smart operations, and which then could be empowered which will be empowered by data analytics in different settings or different flavors, data fusion, machine learning, digital twins, providing us and all the ones that are engaged in this decision basis for balancing the environmental sustainability and the capital productivity. So let me go through a bit on these aspects here and see where this can take us. First of all, we did, when we tried to understand the port call, we did this what we call the metro map in that effort. And what that was meant was to see what are the relationship between the different actors and what are the important timestamps that the different actors need to share with each other so that we can establish some kind of situational awareness. The pieces of information was very clear that those need to be brought together. No one sits on the whole truth. We need to assure that this is something that is allowing everyone to actually contribute to this situation. But on the other hand, also importantly, that the data provider also is a data owner, so that he needs to be able to judge and tell who shall be able to use this. Some examples of ongoing discussions are of course, the IMO initiative on just-in-time shipping and the IMO reference data model, which I think is very promising, referencing a number of different other standards out there. We have brought forward a concept of thinking of elastic time slot management, which is captured in the book. So that would mean that you would be able to actually change your time slot due to the factors that occur. We have the BIMCO's adoption of the virtual arrival clause as well, and we may also talk about virtual queue tickets, as well as maybe in the future we will see market forces pushing for slot trade. And this we captured this in an article me and Hanan and Andre and Francois and Sten-Erik in smart decision making and collaborative environment. Further, if you look up on the maritime appointment economy, you will see that we may talk about we must see that the self-organized ecosystem implies distributed coordination. I just found this small thing on LinkedIn where Kuhn and Nagel was reporting up on a ship that they were waiting for. Kuhn and Nagel is one of the largest transport operators in the world. And there were 29 container vessels carrying 221,000 TEU, in other words, containers, outside Long Beach. And that vessel, Sea Explorer, with 14,800 TEU vessel, it got its berth after waiting 14 days, and then it takes 5 to 7 days for loading, unloading. So almost 3 weeks in Long Beach, and this is not a good situation. So I think the state here needed to be said, and which we also brought out last week, was that we need to look upon port call optimization as two sides of the same coin. The port has an interest to optimize its resources with which it's visited by very many fleets, while the shipping company with their fleet wants to optimize the use of their fleet. And that is two different lorries that pushes that. We also see that there is a lot of local information sharing communities that are existing, for example, inside ports. There is a strong push now from IMO via the European Commission and to national legislation about everything that should be digitalized in reporting formalities starting by 2023, which means that here there's also a very strong push towards more digital interaction. And we also see phenomena such as TradeLens pushing the horizontal information sharing community, where the different local information sharing communities need to be connected in some way. Because at the end of the day, who is the one that requires information? And at the top of this whole value chain, we have the cargo owners. Also we see in standardization, we see that, for example, we have the IMO reference data model. A lot of emphasis is put into that now. UNCFACT has their reference data models and with a multimodal stance. We have had the development and validation of S211 as the port call message format brought forward, and also the Digital Container Shipping Association is providing, for example, a number of different initiatives trying to capture and being an IATA-like organization for container shipping. So looking upon the applications of this then, would then mean that we are talking about a concept where we are transcending beyond seeing the port, not just as a window to the sea, but seeing that as a transport hub or as a multidimensional hub, actually, where one ingredient is looking upon it as a transport hub, and then thereby securing that we can make the transshipment of goods and people, of course, between different modes of transport or within and between different modes of transports. And we see now that, for example, a lot of ports in around the world is now establishing capabilities of being a combi terminal, such as, for example, then transshipping goods from train to truck, etc. We see also that ports are developing towards becoming energy hubs, because if we want to be steaming fossil free, we also need to come to a situation where the fossil freeness needs to be possible to, or the fossil free fuel needs to be provided from someone. And therefore, same thing goes, of course, for electricity as well. And therefore, we need to secure that the ports are becoming energy hubs as well. What we in the electricity market, we see now that there are a number of different collaborations that are established between local energy companies and ports. And as a last ingredient, and first of all, for these two first ones, information systems or digital technologies has an important role, and thereby also we can see for in front of us that the port will become an information hub, and maybe then not just a provider of physical services, but also maybe also on digital services. And as you see in the right hand corner, the port needs to be seen as a hub in relation to many other hubs as well. If you look at smart ships, which is another area, of course, and there's a lot of debate going on at that as well, where we see a smart ship that is something that is digitalized and automated to a higher degree for supporting, for example, then maritime circularity, which would mean that you would track and the different components that the ship is built up, out of, so we can engage in recycling. Autonomous functions supporting the manned operations. The smart ship having digital capabilities to support the emission efficient movements. Also data generation, or it could be a data generator because it's basically moving. I mean, it can report on the wave heights and the temperature and icebergs, etc. And also integrated remote operations, which means that this is a key factor for the fleet operating centers being out there. And many of you know, of course, that when we have the Costa Concordia grounding, that boosted basically the presence of fleet operating centers in the world, and challenged very much about the Mare Liberum 1609, the captain is a king of the sea. So the smart ship is going to provide support for both onboard and onshore operations, but there is very much of regulations that are needed to be changed, and also a stable infrastructure is needed. Going to smart port and smart cargo, we see here that we would have a very interesting phenomenon that is now coming forward, and that is a smart container. And that is fantastic to see that we can equip a container with IoT devices that actually could inform our cargo owners where is the container, and it is multimodal. So that means that we can capture that the presence where the shipment is. We can combine that with other data, so we can also, and also on the data analytics foundations, talk about when will my shipment arrive, what conditions are my goods in, what is the temperature, which is of course highly important in these times. How have my goods been treated along the supply chain? Has anybody dropped the container, etc.? And this then also becomes a driver for situation awareness. We do have what we could be empowered of with the data fusion machine learning, where we all the time are striving to find appropriate techniques for data acquisition, management and analysis and visualization to empower human users to make sense of the spatial temporal data and provide enhanced decision support. And what I think that we are going towards is to use data and information sources that are part of processes of data fusion and machine learning. We use our maritime knowledge and models combined with the maritime situational awareness to provide us with proposed decision and actions. An unresolved quest, of course, is whether we can predict an arrival time to a port, or whether that is something based on data analytics, or if we need the direct interaction with the captain and the fleet operating center. I think this is a combination that is extremely exciting. Also, we have the phenomenon of digital twins, which is something that I really think that it's encouraging, building up on both historical data in data lakes, real-time data streams, mathematical models, and combined with situational parameters, utilizing a digital twin for situational simulation for both long-term and short-term decisions, and long-term and short-term situational awareness. It is defined, or we define the digital twin as a dynamical digital representation of an object or a system. It uniquely describes in a binary format a person, product, or environment's key characteristics and properties, and can be rendered in one or more physical or digital space. And examples of application areas are fleet optimization, port and terminal optimization, optimization of container flows in the end-to-end supply chain. So, at the end of the day, we are really talking about balancing capital productivity and environmental sustainability. You have the organizational point of view, but it needs to be seen in the context of how we respond to the goals or the societal and environmental goals here. And of course, what happens here is that there are some questions that needs to be addressed, such as in order to get more cargo, should a ship spend another day in port or should it sail with a partial load? Or, as another question, should a captain sail between ports at full speed in order to maximize port visits per year? So let me then wrap up here now with some ideas and thoughts that I would like to bring to the table. As we have very many ports in the world that are not digitally mature enough, is it now the situation where we could actually emerge in a digital port maturity index? I remember as the first point here. Second point, I remember when we started talking about airports and in our engagement about developing world-class airports, we had something called Airportpedia. Is it now time for a Portopedia, where we would share best practices between different ports or between different shipping companies or between transport operators, etc.? At RISE, we also work with something called Verified by RISE, and that is building up on ISO 17029. And if we just can come up with a common requirement specification, then we could utilize that as a driver for securing that the industry is actually adopting these type of principles, and then you place a stamp on that. How about open innovation initiatives engaging the crowd? I was myself part of the jury and also a source of inspiration for the Smart Port Challenge 2021 in Morocco just recently. And I was fascinated to see what kind of exciting innovations that the crowd is bringing forward by that. And open innovation has, of course, been a very important and intriguing subject for the informatics community for a long time. How about adopting data analytics methods for enhanced predictability and transparency? How far can we get, really? How about the quality of the data that is out there? Can we validate that by combining different data sets? And what would be the best ways forward to test and demonstrate maritime informatics applications? To be announced, and we have not really announced it yet, but we will have an additional book coming out, and that is a response to that there were some blind spots that was identified by the community that this should be in the book as well. So therefore, we have written a 6 new chapters on digital data streams for humanitarian and the plan, global concerns, a chapter on maritime circularity, a chapter on ports as multidimensional hubs, one on IMO reference data model, one on the role of industry organizations in standardizations, co-written by DCSA and IATA, and also one chapter on supply chain visibility exemplified by a trade lens. So I think that importantly, looking beyond sea transports, we need to look upon the seamless integration to other means of transports, and there would be other application areas, of course, being opened up as well, such as aquaculture, sea protection, coastal zone management, seafood, energy production. So having said this, I think that what we can see is that the maritime sector is moving from a fragmented situation awareness to common situational awareness, from low information quality to high and reliable information quality, from lacking planning horizons to predictable operations, from unstructured information exchange to standardized data exchange, from sub-optimized operations to mature collaboration culture, from unnecessary waiting times to just-in-time operations, from low IT maturity to enhanced IT systems and third-party innovation opportunities. What is also around the corner, and I know that a couple of my academy colleagues is also in the meeting here, is to look up on maritime informatics as a foundation for education and training, and that both concerns academic education, which we already tried at Chalmers in one course, and there's also debates or discussions going on now in how can we enhance the digital capabilities of the tomorrow's maritime worker and in professional training programs. And what can be seen is that we hopefully can use maritime informatics as a foundation for that. So having said all this, I would say that maritime informatics is an applied science for the maritime industry. It engages both practitioners and researchers for a common goal. It promotes standardized digital data sharing throughout the cargo chain. It supports enhanced efficiency, safety, security, resilience, and sustainability in maritime transports. It enables understanding, predicting, advising, and improving maritime activity, and also enables seamless integration into the larger ecosystem. We think that maritime informatics is the key to the future of maritime transports. It is a science for change. It requires the engaged scholarship and reflective practitioner. And also watch ourselves. We need to watch ourselves. We should not pave the cow paths, if you quote Michael Hammer from the early 90s, which is also part of my PhD thesis many years, 19 years back or 20 years back in time. So, to repeat, three focus areas of maritime informatics: digital collaboration, digital data sharing and decision making, and data analytics. And very much of our colleagues and friends out there has been saying that the value of maritime informatics is important. And here you see a couple of different quotes. If you go to www.maritimeinformatics.org, you see that I think that we are now close to 100 quotes that has been formulated by the different type of actors, both from researchers in informatics, people from ports, shipping companies, associations, and global organizations. So I think this was from me, and I think actually I kept myself for almost exactly 45 minutes as was promised. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. This was an amazingly lecture, great overview of the amazingly complex area. So exciting and so important. And you keep track of your time in an amazing way. So I think there are a lot of questions and people that would like to discuss something with you. So I think we could use the hand you found to raise your hand under participants. You can also write the questions in the Q&A. So I think we open up for questions for a few minutes. So if you would like to have raise your hand, that's fine. Fredrik and I try to keep track on the hands. And we have also two questions already in the chat or Q&A.
Okay, shall I take Terry's question first then?
I think Emma was the first.
Emma was first. Okay. Question. Sorry, Emma. Traditional shipping has been very keen to predict this data. With this in mind, what strategies do you suggest to encourage them and other actors within the port call to embrace a more collaborative approach in data sharing? This is a $100 million question. If you go back to, I think that the chapter in the book written by Robert Ward and Nils Bjørn Andersen, we see that from the beginning, sharing nautical information was seen as a competitive advantage. And I think that what IHO, International Hydrographic offices under the International Hydrographic Organization actually pushed was a legislation of that kind of data should be shared. And I think to some extent that is possible if I look into what IMO is trying to do, et cetera, but I also think that we should be very careful because there are other incentives to share data, business intensive, that will never be regulated, but would rather be driven from the different actors to seek their use cases. So having said that, together with that, I think that there will be a tremendous amount of data sources coming out. Then I think that it's not a real case any longer to sit back and hold on to your data. Thank you, Emma. Terje, what are your thoughts on what can happen on ports that do not focus on digitalization and standardization that takes place just now in the maritime area? I think that it will be required by ports of the world to have enough digital capabilities to come into question of whether you should use that port or not as a shipping company, or as a cargo owner, or as a truck operator, etc., etc. We already now see that in some cases, due to the fact that both the digital and the physical infrastructure is better, you choose another port and you choose actually to go by road or by sea to that other port. In that sense.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Michael, for having a splendid presentation here, and you've come a long way, and you're spot on, I guess. We need to digitalize the ports, the cities, and we need to be smarter together. So, congratulations, and thank you for your answer.
It's going fast also, tell you. Next one comes from Norbert from IBM TradeLens, I guess. My view on autonomous ports, what is your view on autonomous ports dealing with autonomous ships? Are you going to address that in your maritime mathematics? I think that you should see it this way. We push enormously hard towards autonomous ships, there's no question about it. But I think that the majority of the ships would rather have autonomous functions on board. And that also comes to the ports then. I remember when I was in a project meeting, the startup meeting of Born to Drive, and that was basically about driving the Volvo car from the to the port, and then they said that the vision would be to get rid of the stevedores because they are a problem, especially in Gothenburg, as you know, so we can automatically load the cars onto the ferry as well. I don't think that we will come there, to be honest, but of course we should in maritime informatics follow these type of movements. Charles, at the point of maturity of informatics digital data collaboration, where are we in 2021? I don't know. I think that it's a lot of noise being made by 20% of the ports in the world, if I take the port sector. I think that the Costa Concordia grounding drove a lot of needs for connecting or having a good monitoring of the ship. I think that we are not at all as far as we should be in connecting what happens at sea with what happens at ports, and we do have a legacy or a challenge in not being able to push for enough digitalization yet. Peter, how many other institutions also have maritime informatics departments? Is there a potential for a global group becoming a hub of excellence, investigation, and also dissemination of third-party initiatives, products, competition? Okay, there are two questions, I guess. The first question, I think that if you look upon the authors or the co-authors of the book, you see that there is a lot of academic institutions that has been engaged in that situation. And I know that they would like to push that to their agenda. Fredrik, you want to say something? Okay. So I think that there is room and it's very good room for an international global maritime informatics group that should be pushing this into the agenda. And I also know that we are trying to talk a little bit to IAMI, is that the name, International Association of Maritime Education, for bringing this to the table as well. Me personally, I think that a global group as a hub of excellence, investigations and also disseminations, I think that would be absolutely excellent. And we see such phenomena out there today with Port Excel, for example, in Rotterdam and Dubai, Singapore, etc. Let's bring maritime informatics at the core and trying to incorporate a number of these different initiatives. Anders, what is your thoughts on mobilizing the crowd for open digital innovation? How do we do it, and what is required in order to ensure results that reach markets? I think that we have seen, and I saw that Fathom World actually published an article where he listed, I think Craig, that listed the 5 years ago hackathons that has been going on. And I must say that it is something that is becoming more and more active. What I think is that we should take a lot of the knowledge that we have gained in open innovation in other fields to actually bring it to the maritime sector as well. And I also think that it is important that we do not only arrange like a contest for the best solution, we should also cater for bringing best solutions into incubators and accelerators. Okay, let me move on. Sergio, do you think that UNCFACT will continue being a standard into the new digital sea arena? UNEDIFACT, I don't know. I cannot answer. I don't know. I would say. From one point of view, the standards that are being pushed the UN is of course highly important, and as UN is a global organization that also enables and is a big reach, and especially out to developing countries. Okay, Christina, can you talk? What is your view on hydro-powered ship ports, I guess, ship ports.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hi.
Can you elaborate on your question a little bit?
Yes, of course. Thank you for your lecture. So we are seeing a lot of calls, research calls, and also calls regarding funding opportunities in terms of H2-powered ships and ports, port infrastructure, and also trains that in terms of transport towards the ports. So I was wondering if you could offer any insights, if you see that as a possible technology that will take over within the next couple of years. What is your view on that?
Yes, I think that things are moving there. I don't know enough about it really, and my colleagues at Rice are much better in this for sure. But using hydrogen both for moving and for storing, etc., is important for moving to the fossil free environment. So my feeling is that is happening, but then I cannot really say too much about it.
Okay, all right, thank you.
So Lena, I have no doubt that you would reach this far, the sky's the limit. What challenges have been the largest one when it comes to explain the need for maritime informatics in the shipping world? I don't know. This is an interesting question, really, because I mean, again, going back to Per-Erik Holmberg and my own talk, we talked about Lighthouse InfoShip, and then me and a couple of others at Rice, we talked about maybe we should use a word like in Swedish, sjöfartens digitalisering, or the digitalisation of maritime operations, rather than talking about maritime informatics, and then we'd reserve maritime informatics for the word that would describe a discipline. But at the end of the day, we now feel that we have been trying to really, really push maritime informatics very hard in many different situations. And it seems to be a framework and an orientation that attracts a lot of people. The important thing is not the concept or the discipline as such. It's rather the use cases and what you can do with it that is important. And I think that we need to push very hard for describing what we can do with it. I also agree with you on the sky is the limit, and I have a favorite quote that I many times use, and that is by Tor Heyerdahl, who was a seafarer, and he on his wall in the museum in Oslo, it says, "Borders, I have not seen any, but they seem to be existing in people's minds." Anonymous attendee. How do you see progression of the adoption of standards and simplified process of and digital solutions such as electronic bill of lading? Is it a question of persistence, or is there a magic trick that we need to learn to perform? Let us, you and myself, anonymous attendee, let us see if we can seek some empirical basis for that. I think personally that electronic bill of lading is fantastically nice, showing what digitalization can do, where we do not have to have the paper going together with a physical object, so we can be prepared in advance. But again, if we then can utilize a number of different business cases to actually show the value of EBL, I think that would be good. So, shall I take what I think? How do you see the interaction of different initiatives, both from governmental organization, association, as well as industry? Let me answer very easy, complementary. I think it is important that we seek opportunities to look above and beyond, to use your type of words, Michael, the specific actor when we're talking about standardizations that are going on. Niklas, thank you also. What are the risks of an ever-increased digitalization of the shipping and maritime industry? I think that we could put another perspective here. What is the risk if we do not do it? Maybe I'm a little bit limited in my view here now, but there are some very big actors out there, such as Amazon and Alibaba, and major international cargo owners of different kinds, and they want to see a higher degree of the predictability coming out of the maritime sector. So therefore, I think it's a very high risk of not doing anything now, so to say. As in all businesses, I mean, we should never detach the human element from technologies. I would like to take also Sten-Erik's question. What is the gap waste area which has surprised you most in the course of your research? That was not a nice question. I think that what I have learned, this is very intriguing and so on, is that it is very strong competition existing in the maritime sector. And I think that we need to take a number of different initiatives that actually glue and empower the collaboration between different people. And I thought from the beginning I was extremely naive and went in I remember we had some discussions on some kind of advisory board, and I was saying that let's introduce this and this, because that is what has been done in the aviation sector, and it couldn't be any problem. And they just started throwing apples and pears on me, because Mikael, you need to understand that the maritime sector acts in a much different way, so to say. So I think from my point of view, this step-by-step approach, I think that is very important, and let us hope for that we can take some leaps now when such things or phenomena such as maritime informatics has come to the table. So, no more questions.
I think there was the last question. I know there are some other questions in the chat, but I think it's time to sum up. And I mean, this subject it is so interesting, and there are so many questions and so many things to discuss. So we could go on forever, I think. But to sum up this fantastic lecture and a lot of quite tricky questions from the audience, I would say it was a great lecture. I'm impressed of your work, Mikael. So this will be the final step for you being an adjunct professor at Chalmers in collaboration with RISE. So I would like to thank the audience for giving all the interesting questions, and you can still connect to Mikael and continue the dialogue. And thank you, Mikael, for this amazing lecture. So if anyone would say a last word, Frederick or someone, otherwise, I think Mikael Hegg raised a hand. Mikael, would you say something? You have the last word.
Ooh. You better be good now, Mikael.
Yeah.
Just kidding.
I see you have your hand up in the...
So this is Mikael Hegg from RISE, and from RISE we also just want to say thank you very much for a good lecture. And for us, this is also a very important step for the cooperation between Chalmers and RISE. So thank you very much, Mikael.
Thank you, Mikael. I also see that Åsa from Lighthouse, you will have the definitely last word here, but would you like to say something, Åsa, before we finish?
Yes, I would like to say thank you very much for a very interesting lecture, and so happy. I'm even more happy now than I was 6 years ago when I first saw that things actually are happening, digitalization in the port, since when I left port businesses in 2009, we didn't have any of that. So I'm very happy that you have come so far, that we have come so far.
Let's continue to collaborate, all of us. I think that's important.
I think that's the future, as you said before in your lecture. The collaboration is key here. So thank you very much, all of you. So thank you, and take care. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.